way it's going to be, that's the way it's going to be. So, as the sun slowly rises in the east, don't look for me because I'll be sleeping. Bye. And my name may be Lutina, but this is KPFA and KPFB Berkeley, KFCF Fresno. Stay tuned for Over the Edge. Well, you know, sometimes, just to let you know that Lutina had nothing to do with the pregnant pause that you heard just then.
He's innocent.
I'm completely innocent as usual, but I can tell you that it's somebody else in the room that's not that innocent, really.
The WMCA weather scope, fair, quite warm and humid tonight with a low about 70. The wind is southwest at 10 miles an hour, humidity 52%. WMCA Midtown temperature 86 degrees. The top news of the hour, President Johnson has arrived in New Orleans for an inspection of Hurricane Betsy's damage to Louisiana. Frank Stickle with all the news by all means, brought to you by HFC. Borrow confidently from HFC. More news at 8:30 on The Good Guys Show with Gary Stevens. This is WMCA New York.
WMCA. It's the home of the good guys.
Well, if you're following the show closely, you'll realize that there are several things wrong. But, you know, who cares? I don't. And this is Over the Edge, at last, finally on the air. And tonight, a very special edition, as we do every month. It has five Thursdays in it, and this is one of them. We're here for 5 hours, till 5 a.m., with Over the Edge tonight. And, of course, it's How Radio Isn't Done, Part 4. Well, people are asking, how many parts can there be? How long is this going on? I would like to know. And so would I, but you ain't heard nothing yet. There's a whole lot of How Radio Isn't Done. And I see this as a 8, a 10, a 12, or 15-part series, maybe 18, maybe 20, maybe 22. 25 is not out of the question. And if I find even more stuff, we could go to 30, part 30. That would be up into what? Now, see, that one stopped. If you're listening closely, you'll notice all kinds of things are wrong. Did I hit that? Or I don't know. As you can tell, this is How Radio Isn't Done, Part 4.
Business to help improve radio properties. With a foundation of the best programming people in the business.
Stop the music, please.
Let's get serious
from here. From Dr. Firesign's accounting firm for the Fireside Theater, here's the latest note from the American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers.
Uh-huh.
Austin, Philip, third quarterly distribution, 1970.
Yeah.
Total deductions, $2.63. Net distribution, $0000000000000.
You can borrow on that number of zeros, Mr. Austin.
Well, here's the reason for such a high amount of money given to Mr. Austin Fnimpt. No surveyed performances.
No surveyed performances? Yeah. Well, if they can't watch you, they can't pay you.
Yeah, that's right.
No watchy, no pay.
Well, you know,
can I have a tin smacker, please?
Sure.
Come in. Come in.
No,
come
no,
in.
The carpenters
yeah.
are working
Hello.
On the new building.
Oh, the new building. Yeah, ASCAP doesn't pay for comic performances.
Who's that?
You know?
Yeah, I'm the carpenter.
Oh, you are?
Yeah,
huh?
You thought I was the guy from the other show, didn't you?
I thought you were an astronaut.
No, yeah, I am an astronaut, too, you know.
Oh,
yeah,
not.
I'm also a car salesman, and I'm on Julia twice a week.
Oh,
you are?
Yeah.
What's it like to be on Julia? Yuck.
Well,
I never
yuck,
made it, as you know, with an integrated poison.
It's what you call plastic.
Plastic?
Yeah. So,
that's
yeah.
what we used to blow up the Union Life building yesterday.
It certainly was.
Right.
I'm sure having a good time being Vice President of the United States.
Oh, you are?
Oh, yeah. My name's Spiro Agnew.
How do you do?
How do you do?
My name
how do you
is
do
John
what?
Wilberforce Boogie.
What
you
do
guys,
you do?
You
what do I do? I'm the head of the Bureau of Hot Air Vents.
We pick people like us.
Hello.
I just pushed that button.
Hi, George.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
Problem.
Yeah.
You're talking about the lovely flavors and strength.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
But of course, we do buy the English cheeses, and we had a Red Leicester this week.
Yeah.
We do that. We
yes.
Break,
yeah, absolutely.
Okay, George.
Thank you.
Thorough research and state-of-the-art technical quality.
Bon appetit.
TM's formats work.
Right, I must talk about Stilton.
Talk about Stilton.
Stilton, I have got some fantastic Stilton here.
They deliver ratings and sales. For now, for the future. In a decade fascinated by statistics and...
Do you know?
...ruminated by surveying...
Do you know it takes 17 gallons of milk to make one cheese?
Keep these facts in mind.
Fantastic.
I don't know who's on line 1A, but I'll say hello.
According to the spring 79 Arbitron figures, 65% of all TM programming clients surveyed rank number 1 or 2 in their target demographic.
Wonderful. You guys know that you can get high by eating plastic bombs?
Oh, great. Are those the ones made out of detergent?
No. The plastic that they use to blow up things. Plastic.
Get you high?
Favorite terrorist tool.
Get you high, man?
Dummies.
Fixed your teeth.
Yeah, it gets you high. Gets
yeah,
you
I bet
high.
It does.
Get you high if it blows cavities. Up in your hand, too.
Yeah.
Yuck.
Pain gets you high, man.
Yeah, pain gets you. Let you know you're alive. Read La Condition Humaine by Malraux.
Went to college, huh?
Right now?
In fact, TM Programming, as a company, will perform 35% better than the median of any format in any market, no matter what the competition. We invite you now to sample the 5 successful formats of TM Programming.
Are we in again? Oh, dear. The show's already begun. All of a sudden, it just started. I was looking the other way.
Just a moment, everyone stop, please.
Be sure we run in and say, don't you dare put this part on the air. This is our private conversation between the members of Negative Land before they begin.
We have a beginning to the show, and here it is.
You sure you want to start? Maybe they've started.
Through a notion of media, we drag Arnet gathering into what is ours.
Well, the beginning screwed
this
up.
This is the universal media network.
Why isn't that there?
What do you think? One channel only? Why do you think that's happening? I'm over here.
The universal media network. Forget your previous attempts to
I can hear it, but it's only in one side. Don't you dare put this over the air. Look at that engineer waving his arms frantically, saying, but you're on the air.
Ladies and gentlemen, you'll have to excuse us. We've just gotten off the road, and this is Negative Land. And we're trying to get organized here in a completely unfamiliar studio. Should that be there now?
I don't know.
You see, here we are in a brand new high-tech WNUR radio station. And of course, as time passes, technology changes. And I have brought a great many cards into this station. Dennis, groovy music. Right. And it turns out that, of course, no one uses those machines anymore. They're passé. They're old analog technology.
I think your mic was down too low, Crosley. Say it again. He just turned you up, though.
Well, I'm not speaking too loudly here. But all right. Well, we have some technological... what would you call that?
Difficulties.
Yes. And because I brought some technological difficulties into the station, and they can't play them.
Well, they
gosh darn that.
I heard one just a second ago. It was just on one side.
Let's see if this works.
It's a good thing we're not on the air, because this is just the rehearsal.
No, it's not there.
Right?
Oh, that's such a shame, because we have such good material on.
I'm sure when the red light goes on, I don't see the light. I don't know where it's mounted, even. But I'm sure it's around somewhere.
This is Negative Land, and we're on tour, and we're here in, where the hell are we?
Evanston, Illinois. Yes.
And I'm Crosley Bendixson, and with me is Velma and Tara, our on-the-road mechanic, and, of course, Bob.
Yep.
Or Bob, as we call him. Bob.
Representing the conundrum that has become Negative Land on this exciting V-less adventure.
And this is just part of our over 60-person crew. We take on the road in, 12 vans?
It was 11 now as of yesterday, but we'll get to that later.
They get all spread out on the road, and we lose track of them, but some of them are here. Anyway, we've been having just a terrible time, and as you can surmise, this is another one of those promotional appearances where the band shows up in town and tries to get you to come to their show. Well,
too bad. There's only one problem with that.
The joke's on you, because the show was last night. Being Negative V Land, we often do things backwards, and that's what we're doing here today. The show was last night. Hope you enjoyed it. And we're here today to promote the fact that you missed it. That card's not going to happen, is it?
Oh, sure. It was going on both channels right strong earlier today. Just recently, in fact.
Just keep hitting that anytime you feel like there's short little bits on there. Those are our UMN IDs, which we've brought with us, because everywhere we go is the Universal Media Network while we're there. And then, when we go, it's not anymore.
That's why we're here with you.
But we can't get it to work, and that's so unfortunate, because our best material exists in this format,
which is
now obsolete and no longer used by radio.
But I hope you know it is there.
What?
It's just in one channel.
I don't hear any IDs.
You mean you didn't know you've been running them the whole time? Well, it's a really good thing we're not on the air, isn't it? I'm going to leave.
All right, Velma, just be quiet a minute. Velma, quiet. We've been having this problem with her the whole tour. She's a high-tension, high-maintenance merch seller. And right, could everyone just be quiet to see if I can hear this?
Forget your previous...
I don't hear it.
How
come I can't hear it?
The Universal Media Network.
What? Oh, that could be. Let me try that again. I still don't hear it. I do not hear it. But he says he can hear it. What are you hearing when you say you hear it?
I hear it in my well, one channel.
What are you hearing? What are you hearing?
I hear it in the right channel only.
Okay, that's because that's what the machine says too on the meter, so that's fine. But what are you hearing when you're saying you're hearing?
I'm hearing a computer voice talking about UMN.
That is correct. You
well,
are correct.
Is that what you're supposed to be playing?
You win. A sex dirt CD from Negatively Liam.
Oh, that's my favorite, too.
And that's the worst seller, and that's why we give them away. I got to be able to hear it.
Oh, that's my favorite.
Ride the accident.
I have a volume control on these headphones.
Land safe.
Oh, where are they? All right, now everybody relax. We're going to start the program. What time is it?
It's time to go.
Well, we're running a little late, so, folks,
thanks
it's been
for
a
coming.
Pleasure
it's
to be
been
here.
A good
I
time.
Hope you've enjoyed some of our material.
And we'll be back again another time. Until then, it's Over the Edge Mobile here.
Just kidding.
WONE.
Kiss me where it smells funny.
Honey?
Go on. Act like you never done it before. 98 Rock. I'm serious.
Room Programming presents first new format of the decade. Alpha One. The beginning.
I am alive.
I keep holding on.
Alpha One.
I promise.
A beat of its own.
Of course, the records that you hear may be. If they are dead, ring up KUCI and tell them they're playing a load of beep, 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 beep. Because you're not allowed to say that. But if you were allowed to say it's a load of beep, 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 it's not on KUCI. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Alpha One is the answer for the growing general market urban contemporary listener. Programmed by PD of the Year Jack Patterson, Alpha One is the format for the times. Ahead of the times, it is tomorrow.
If there's a cure for this, I don't want it.
No, I don't want to say what I want. I want to say what you want. Because I'm here to please.
Alpha One, it has arrived. Alpha One, the newest sound from TM Programming.
I am here to please. I am the most pleasing person you ever in your life.
I got it right here. I can do it. I mean, never doubt. No, but
I've got some interest here.
I mean, it'd be hard, you know.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Listen, I wrote
What's next?
Oh, listen, I thought I'd do a little social consciousness. Jupiter, looked at from both sides, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, the spirit of social consciousness invades. Dear friends, for just a quick second. I wrote in my first propane-operated car today, by the way. Yeah, right. Gas-operated car works just fine.
Yes.
Only pollutes the air 25%.
Oh, you mean it's not El Perfecto, man? It's
perfection?
Not,
what are you, some
like
sort of a Navajo?
Walk down to the neighborhood store.
What are you, some sort of a realized man? I'm 75% clean now.
I'm Dr. IQ.
Dr. IQ?
Yeah.
You remind me.
I've got the multiple identity.
No, you don't.
Yeah,
no, you don't.
Oh, yeah, I do. I can switch them sometimes. You can do 100 voices.
Well, that Negro that was here?
No.
Yeah, no. Well, that was me.
I mean, I don't know him personally. I don't. Well, I presume he didn't show me his wrist.
No.
Hi, this is Bing Crosby, and this is a little bit of advice on how to handle teenagers. Teenagers are positively people, so try to remember they have a lot of problems, mainly parents. When their jive talks give you the heebie-jeebies, and their rootin' tootin' clothes, who's talking, make you despair for civilization, better bear up and shut up. Because they'll grow up and get over with it, just as you and I.
Right on!
Scratch most little teenagers and you'll find a solid citizen.
Get your fingernails off of me, Daddy-O!
You know, when they sound off with ideas for improving the world we made, well, maybe us parents could learn something if we'd stop snooting the kids.
Maybe you parents could get some good nookie, man, if you stayed close to the young kids. Right, I mean, I think that youth sex is perhaps the answer for most 45 and 50 year old.
And here they come now, down on the field. It's youth.
The youth sex teams
it's
are both
wonderful
out
to see
on
our parents, but Charlie.
They're beautiful, Larry. Never seen 20 marching legs as trim.
Oh, there's the armored guard coming by right now. Right now, that's really beautiful.
There's the 4-year-olds. The 4-year-olds are coming to the field, and men all over the stadium are raising, ladies and gentlemen, right now, standing up in a show of appreciation.
That's
beautiful
really
little girls.
The flag is coming by.
Yes, yes.
Here it comes.
Yes,
here it comes.
Yes.
And there's nothing on the back of it.
That's a big surprise.
Very nice.
It's all white on the back, ladies and gentlemen, so the game will go on today without code 2 rules.
That's what it means. Well, the clock is getting pretty close.
Kids are going to be able to watch this one today.
9:01. Oh, the kids are out there in force now. The Exposition Park is full of them.
There's Major Hortabagy's little Black Eagles.
That's right.
400 perfectly trained 7-year-olds, by the way. All of Hungarian background.
Ah, look at that. Here comes the dog corps. Isn't that wonderful? The canine patrol is
coming in. Dog upon dog upon dog upon dog.
Bob, if I may interrupt here for a minute, that's from the Dog and Dentists Council of East Los Angeles, these dogs. And all of them have appeared in the film.
Well, that's just fine. I see the orchestra's on the other end of the field now.
Oh, look.
Here come the mules.
Here come the mules. The La Cucaracha Mule Corps.
That's right.
And here comes their spiritual leader, Darlene. That mule has a wagger. Oh, boy.
Get off the table, Mabel. The quarter's for the beer.
Well, that was the Pledge of Allegiance.
Got another one down there.
Yes,
that was Bill. He's gone.
Paranoia. He comes like a diamond merchant, they say.
Paranoia. Paranoia.
Oh, no.
Turn and run if you want to, but face this fact. If they don't get you now, more of them are likely to later.
The Far Sign Theater from their 60s, late 60s Oz radio series on our sister station here in L.A. I have one of those mental blocks. I cannot remember the call letters of our sister station in L.A. I know it. I just can't remember it. Well, this often happens in how radio isn't done. And back announcing like that, telling you what I played. Maybe that would help. Maybe that would help radio. So from the Firesign Theater to one member, David Osman. This is David Osman on the telephone telling a story about how radio isn't done. Boy, the CDRs aren't working in any machines tonight. Well, if I could swear in German, I would. No, it's not going to play. All I can do is try another machine. Hang on. This is How Radio Isn't Done, KPFA in Berkeley. No machine will play it. My only alternative last final choice is to try the machine in which the CD I'm playing now is playing, so I'll have to stop that. The time is right now. This machine works, so there you go.
When was it? It was 1982. And it was the summer of 1982. No, it was right about Memorial Day. Okay. Yes, I was doing my something like 26th program, 5-hour Sunday arts magazine program called, not surprisingly, The Sunday Show for NPR. It was going out live 5 hours every Sunday, an enormous amount of program material to produce. And I was living in Washington, D.C. This is just before Memorial Day in 1982. We had gone on the air in April. And every show for me was like an experiment. A pilot. And so I piloted going to famous NPR cities like San Francisco and doing a kind of 5-hour blitz of local culture and covering. We went to Santa Fe. We covered a festival in. Where was it? The Spoleto Festival in Charleston, South Carolina. And, you know, each one of these were kind of, can we do this? Can we go someplace? Can we broadcast remote? And so this mode of experimentation, which was despised by the people in power at NPR, the vice president of programming walked in and looked at the big board that all of this was being written up on so that we knew what we were doing, and said, death wish. Death wish, he says. Here we're struggling to put this huge program together. So we knew he didn't like it. And what they wanted was sort of, you know, wall-to-wall classical music recorded at the Kennedy Center because they had a lot of it on hand. So we are looking at things to celebrate. We celebrate 1932 and because we have a concert of music from 1932. So we have, you know, Broadway personalities and what was playing and all kinds of wonderful stuff, you know, kind of like, you know, all those educational television channels rolled into one. Entertaining. And it came up to the 70th birthday. Here it was on the calendar. Avoided the 70th birthday of one of my personal heroes, John Cage. And we had to celebrate this. And we, of course, had to do it in such a way so that we wouldn't frighten people. And so we commissioned John Cage to do a piece for NPR, the only piece that, of course, NPR ever commissioned. I had worked with him in my distant past at WBAI in New York when it was first a community station. And Cage and David Tudor came up into the studio and did something incredible with turntables and talking into microphones. Well, that's what he came up with. At this time, in 1982, we were doing a live mix of San Francisco, Minneapolis, I think Los Angeles, New York, Washington. You know, we were out there, six beams going up to the satellite. And John Cage was in the studio speaking these oracular and Zen Buddhist aphorisms. And in each of the studios, in each of the radio stations around the country, the music director or his slave or her slave was was measuring down the cabinets in the music library and going, for example, 10 inches down on the third shelf from the bottom. And at that place, one would find, let's say, the Atlantic Rhythm and Blues album for 1947. And that would go on the turntable, and at precisely the right moment, the turntable would be started, and these records would start to play. So there's this wonderful cacophony of public radio sound that's mixing in this very spectacular kind of way. I don't know what John was doing, because I was in the studio as the host of the show. And he had a young woman with him who was the female voice, and she was doing this oracular thing. And from around the country, from all of these stations, beamed up by satellite using NPR's fantastic engineering skills, here were coming these a mix of comedy records, classical music, light, light pop, jazz, just, you know, Shakespeare. It was like it was like the Beatles' Walrus. It was like number nine. It was all of that was going on, and you had to be there because it was moment by moment by moment by moment. It was, in other words, perfect radio. And this only lasted, 9 or 10 minutes, and it had been set up in a very careful way by the older musicologist man at NPR. They always had to have an authority. I wasn't an authority, I was a voice. And he, you know, went through why this experimental music was what it was and what its significance and who John Cage was. And then we did this thing, and it was over, and it was fabulous, and everybody shook hands, and, you know, it was exhausting, and I walked away, and then I had to go downstairs to the engineering room where everything is recorded, and remember, everything was being recorded on tape, which has since deteriorated completely, I might add, because this was 1982, and the oxide came off the plastic. So I went down, and I had to speed up one of my reads to catch up some time in an hour. You know, I speed it up by 10 seconds or something because they were completely on the clock and had to bang these 5 hours of tape were repeated twice, I think, so that everybody in every time zone could get them whenever they wanted to get them in whatever order they were going to play them. It was very complicated. And so I did my little reread and trimmed out the 10 seconds or whatever they needed, and went upstairs and was called in to my immediate superior's office. And my boss. And my boss said to me, "You're fired. Have your office empty on Monday morning." Monday was Labor Day. And so I did. And realizing, of course, that this was the culmination of, you know, violating the sacred premises of NPR as it then was, with John Cage's, why people might have turned off the radio. I mean, you know, this is the prevailing thing. It would frighten our good listeners who are only used to Beethoven's sonatas played at the Kennedy Center. But it had been going badly for quite some time, and I kind of realized there in my boss's office that this was You know, this, I guess we had to come to a parting of the ways. And I was very sad to do it because, geez, there, I had lots of experiments that I wanted to perform later on. And if there is a small irony to this, a couple of them, when John Cage's 75th birthday came around 5 years later, you couldn't get enough of him on National Public Radio. It only took 5 years, so I'm slightly ahead of the time. And the next time I met Cage was at a, it was sort of a poetry and sort of a sound, it was like a sound conference. And there were a lot of poets there, and there were people from radio as well. I remember Michael McClure was there. And John Cage was there. And I told him this story a little more succinctly than I've told it to you. I told him this story, and he kissed me on both cheeks and said, thank you. And so I thought that was the great reward for this moment of classic and great radio, which I don't think there's any record of. But if there is, you know, God bless him. He was one of my heroes.
I suppose, accept this fact. They're after you. Who knows
so
why?
Nicely out blowing their shoulder again.
Even if they don't know it themselves.
Basically said, you guys don't have to tell me.
Howard Stern's show is off the air on the biggest radio network in the country.
I used to suck off Keith Richards, but he doesn't like it anymore.
Clear Channel suspended Stern's show indefinitely on its station.
Orlando, where we're number one.
Broadcaster.
When are you going to go down fighting?
Locally, you can hear Stern on radio station WCCC-FM. That's in Hartford. The station tells NBC 30 this morning it will continue to run his show.
Hey, I am so happy to have you guys this morning, man. I've always listened to CCC. Never been happier that you're non-corporate. It's always been like that, and I thank you guys. I really do.
Nobody pulls out screen.
Thank God for you guys. I'd be going nuts without my Howard in the morning, dude.
I just want to say thanks for keeping Howard Stern on the air. But you guys got balls. Thank you very much, and that a boy. I'm also a member of the Connecticut Army National Guard, and I listen to your station every day.
We're not corporate. WCCC is your home for Howard Stern.
Thank you.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
The best music, WCLS.
Get up, stand up. Stand up for your right.
Melissa?
Wink, I'll take favorite radio stations for 200.
Okay. I'm the common name that puts Mr. Rogers in the land of make-believe during his root canal. Melissa?
You are the X?
That is it for $200.
105.9 The X.
Issue and for crafting this bill, which underscores the principle that those who've been given multi-billion-dollar assets in the form of public airwaves for free, courtesy of the taxpayers, owe in return at least some consideration of the tax-paying audience and the public interest they purport to serve. I like free enterprise, and the opportunity for every business to turn a profit. I support unlimited artistic creativity. None of these provide a reason for multi-billion dollar spectrum subsidies for profit-making entertainment, particularly when it is indecent, obscene, and profane. While others in telecommunications pay for their slice of the airwaves, the broadcasting industry has been given multi-billion dollar slices of the public airwaves for free. In the 1990s, every other industry that uses the airwaves, such as wireless phone companies, paid for their pieces of the airwaves through public auctions that generated billions in revenue for taxpayers. The broadcasting industry has paid nothing to the taxpayers for their continued free use of this valuable public asset.
GM Country, the crossroads of American music. Today's country music knows no boundaries. It's a combination of traditional roots and contemporary artists appealing to adults everywhere.
Suspicion. I can't help it, you're just so good. Somebody's gonna steal.
The country influence is growing. There's no mistaking its role in mass appeal American music.
Johnny, rosin up your bow and play your fiddle hard, cause hell's broke loose in Georgia and the devil deals the cards. And if you win, you get this shiny fiddle made of gold, but if you lose, the devil gets your soul.
It takes a very special kind of format to fill all the needs of today's adult country listener. The music is the cream of the crop. Country's best current hits and classics, always freshly updated. TM Country is a total format approach, designed for maximum music flow, minimum clutter, and strong call letter identification, with custom jingles and IDs.
I'm single in a double bed, toss and turn and try as you walk it. Many years ago, way out east of town, overcome the orchards. No more lonesome whistles carry on the breeze.
Riding on the city of New Orleans, Illinois Central, Monday morning rail. 15 cars and 15 restless riders, 3 conductors and 25 sacks on mail.
Now as far as I can see, it's an empty railroad bed. No station calls to me from down the line. I find myself slipping through the darkness, hoping just to see headlights shine.
All along the southbound Odyssey, the train pulled out at Kankakee and rolled along past houses, farms, and fields.
Step right in.
Passing trains that have no name, and graveyards full of old black men, and the graveyards of the rusted automobiles.
Right.
Good morning, America, how are you?
I've just stepped off a ghost train. It's never coming back. Years and years together, heading down a one-way track. The rails along the road, fighting dreams to cast aside. But the ghost train still moves onward, and you're taking one last try.
I'm the train they call the city of New Orleans.
And if
Frankfurter.
And I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done. Dealing cards with the old man in the club car. Pity a point, ain't no one keeping score. Pass the paper bag that holds the bottle. Feel the wheels rumbling beneath the floor.
Ride the accident.
And the songs of Pullman porters and the songs of engineers. Ride your father's magic carpet made of steel. Mothers with their babes asleep. Rocking to the gentle beat. And the rhythm of the rails is all they feel.
I still feel a chill go down to my soul when I think about how some things are no more. There's so much lost and so much never gained. Like a pouch of gold dust scattered on the floor. I just step off the ghost train. It's back.
Good morning, America, how are you? Say, don't you know me? I'm your native son. I'm the train they call the city of New Orleans.
Years and years together, heading down a one-way track.
That's it, step right in.
Ghost train still rolls onward, and you make one last ride.
I'll be gone 500 miles when the day is done.
Ride the accident. That's it, step right in. Ride the accident.
Cars in Memphis, Tennessee. Halfway home, we'll be there by morning. Through the Mississippi darkness, rolling down to the sea. But all the towns and people seem to fade into a bad dream. And the steel rails still ain't heard the news. Songs again, the passengers will please refrain. This train has got the disappearing railroad blues.
The rails rumble and like dreams are cast aside. But the ghost train still moves onward, and you make him one last ride. And the ghost train still moves onward, and you make him one last ride.
Good morning.
Don't you know me?
Come on, ride the accident.
Just what she sees in me. You can't treat me any way you have a mind to, 'cause I'm blind in love with you.
A full-time commitment to successful country programming, with continuing consultation from the very first day. And, of course, TM standards of quality control and station support are unsurpassed in the industry.
If I said you have a beautiful body, would you hold it against me? Dream on. Dream about the world we're gonna live in one fine day.
Have you loved the one you left me for? Has she heard like me that slamming door?
Somewhere in the complex of radio formats, there's one sound that's right for your station and your audience.
Got a blood transfusion. He doesn't like it. It's not rock and roll. He doesn't like me to suck his penis. So I won't anymore. Not allowed. Dead.
Process a little bit. I'm supposed to ask about process.
The process.
The countdown will begin this morning at 9, right here on WMNS. God damn, what a call letter. Let me do it again. The countdown will begin this afternoon at 1, right here on the entertaining 1410 WHLN.
On top of that, every TV station owner was recently given more free bandwidth to convert to digital TV, and that additional loan spectrum has an estimated value of perhaps $100 billion. That's a payment from every man, woman, and child in America of $350.
The process.
As we complete action on this bill, our attention turns naturally to the underlying question of whether taxpayers should continue the multi-billion dollar subsidies of this obviously for-profit industry.
Tell me a question. WKRM. The countdown will begin this Sunday afternoon at 2, right here on WKRM 1340, where we're getting involved with your shit.
Я воспрест дисте медиар энергии. Ich bin ein riesiger elektrischer Generator. Ich liefere Ihnen Licht und Kraft und ermögliche es Ihnen, Sprache, Musik und Bild durch den Äther auszusenden und zu empfangen. Ich bin Ihr Diener.
Sounding bored and grumpy.
I will make certain that he does not sound whiny.
I don't know what's wrong. Well, this is how radio isn't done. KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno. KPFA.org on the net, if you're listening in Germany. That's what you're listening to. However, you know, you can also pick it up at KFCF.org and at negativeland.com. We also stream the show live and archive it for a week, as does KPFA. Convenient listening for all. How radio isn't done can reach you any time of day now.
Maybe
maybe we should read out the telephone number, so then when the...
Not
when
yet, Velma.
No?
Hi.
Wait a minute. We not only don't say hello, we don't say hi either.
Oh, excuse me.
That's all right. Maybe you're new to receptacle programming. When your phone stops ringing, you're on the air. Don't say hello.
Hardly.
Now, go ahead with your comment or criticism.
Who's this?
This is Mr. Edge.
Mr. Edge?
That's right.
I thought Mr. Edge was on vacation.
I should be, but I'm not. I almost got fired for that show last week, but I scraped back by the skin of my fingernails.
You're Mr. Edge himself.
I'm Mr. Edge himself, owner and operator of Over the Edge.
Hi, Todd.
Your comment or criticism?
I have no comment or criticism.
Well, what's left after that?
I'm not sure.
I'm not either. This is one of the dangers of receptacle programming.
You could look at it that way.
People will call up and have absolutely nothing to say.
And I say, God bless it.
Oh, I wanted to say that my father was a man like St. Francis.
He was.
He was.
How would you characterize that?
Well, it's the simple truth.
Well, how would you characterize St. Francis? A lot of us aren't into religion and don't really know what he was like, and so therefore have no idea what your father was like.
He was a gentle and kindly man.
Did you know there was skiing in St. Francisco today?
There was what?
Skiing in St. Francisco today.
It snowed.
No, it didn't. But there was skiing anyway.
Listen, I want to tell you that I'm going to be passing through town on my way to Greeley, Colorado.
Which town?
Your town.
Okay.
And I was wondering if I could sign up for Thursday evening.
Sign up?
Sign up.
What would that get you?
In the door, I hope.
Well, I don't usually have guests here at the program because I don't know why. I don't know why the hell why, but I don't.
How's Mr. Pass?
Mr. Who?
Pass.
Pass? How do you spell that?
Pass. P-A-T-H.
Mr. Path?
Uh-huh.
I don't know who you're referring to.
Mr. Shining Pass.
Don't know who that is.
You're slipping, my friend.
I'm getting confused. Talk to this person.
All right.
Howdy-ho, Don. With snow in San Francisco, that means Christmas can't be far away now, can it?
Oh, whoopee.
I'm waiting for Christmas. You know who this is?
No.
This is Mr. Hanky, the Christmas Poo. I love you. Are you coming up to the show sometime?
Yes.
Are you smoking Camels or Marlboros?
Actually, Senecas.
Oh, Senecas. Oh, those are bad for you.
Well, this is what happens in receptacle programming. You know, you never know what you're going to get, and you can't count on people being entertaining.
You were thinking about the Pacifica station KPFK.
That is correct, KPFK. That's where the Fire Sign Theater had their Oz radio series for many years.
And I might add, recent developments over the years at KPFK have only elevated the sanctified status of your great station. A lot of the greatest programmers that I liked anyway were driven away by various evil policies of that station. The only decent programmer left is the same one that occupies your time slot, but every night of the week.
You know, I've never even heard KPF. What was it again?
KPFK.
I don't know why I can't remember that. I know it very well, but it's slipping my mind tonight for some reason. The K is not coming through.
It was a really great science fiction-oriented show that used to be on, and the station stepped in and demanded copyright ownership over all of the programs. And rather than submit to that outrage, he moved the program to the web. But KPFA is still wonderful.
About copyright issues now, are you, Don? You've had a few of those yourself, haven't you? Had to hire a couple of lawyers, get things ironed out.
Yes, but I have never been bugged by my station about copyright.
Yeah, but you almost kicked off another show.
That's right.
You're in a much more laid-back area, and there's something about the Los Angeles area that brings out the greed and even the most
Whiny voice. Why don't you show up?
What's this guy mumbling about on the other side?
Where's that girl you had last week? Was she real or was she recording?
It's Adrian. He's a very bitter man.
I think you have issues, sir.
I've got subscriptions. Thank you very much.
That's why I confined him.
I don't want to talk to you. I want to talk to Mr. Edge.
That's why I confined him.
No, I didn't talk to you. You want to talk to me? You're a bum.
He's just completely annoying and unmanageable.
What can we do? Maybe we need to shackle him or something.
Well, in 1989, I confined him to the black hole tube, where he still is and calls from all the time.
Well, the mistake was that you confined the phone with him.
That's right. We've got to get some technicians down in there and get those phones ripped out, because it just makes it very annoying to have him continue to call. And he always, eventually he'd get really mad and just swear, and I have to cut him off.
Like that guy who left a message last week. Boy, he didn't seem wanting much of an audition there.
You're just pulling things out of your ass now.
Hey, you. Shut up.
Don't you tell you to me.
I said shut up.
And you told me to shut up?
You're
a bum.
You're over.
I don't want to hear from you anymore.
I see what you mean, John.
Don't
make me tell you again.
Don't you tell me anything.
Don't make me snap my fingers in your direction. I don't think I like you. I command you to commit suicide.
Oh, hi, Kitty. I'm glad you came into my room.
I went drinking with a friend who accepted a teaching position at Tulane last night. That's teaching modern music composition to undergraduate and graduate students. He's back in the Bay Area looking for new work. I guess Tulane opens again in January, but it's not going to be the same. Most of the libraries were kept in the basement, and Tulane received 15 to 25 feet of water, depending on the point.
Oh, my.
And the campus.
Everything's gone. Just let us be a lesson to those who have archives. Keep them on the upper floors.
Yeah, keep them on the upper floors.
And don't have them in a floodplain. In fact, don't have them in a big city at all, because all the cities are only targets of destruction, that everything inside gets wiped out eventually.
Well, eventually.
I mean, when you have all these museums and stuff,
oh, yeah.
Those are the last stages of the existence of many an object. The other thing is to duplicate it and have a digital copy made in more than one place. Very small copies. You got to scan stuff. Only 1 or 2% of the world's knowledge is on the web now, and an awful lot of work is. In fact, it can never be completely put on the web because it grows more than anybody can archive it.
Or perhaps we could stack them so high that it wouldn't even matter that they were flammable.
Oh, I'm tired of talking.
Where we
where we're getting, where we are getting involved with you. Is that the way you're saying?
I'm going to start the show now, all right?
Oh, yeah, we have a start.
This is some of Negativity Land, and we're here at WNUR FM in, where's it again?
Illinois. But make sure that Steve guy's got my Metamucil coming, because I'm getting at the point where I can't wait any longer.
She's so hard to deal with. You should see her in the van. All right, and we're here to promote, as I said, I guess you heard all that. Why should I go over that again? All right, now we begin the program. This is, what is this? What is program is this, Thelma?
This is the Over the Edge Chicago Mobile Program.
All right, that's not very funny.
Evanston, I don't know.
All right, it's I don't know, with Negativity Land, and we're with the Universal Media Network, and now finally I can prove that.
Through an ocean of media, we drag ArtNet, gathering into us what is ours. This is the Universal Media Network.
Harold.
Oh, I'm coming.
No, that's not Harold.
Sorry, I had to make a good foamy beverage out of my Metamucil formula. I've done that now successfully. Hi. The cargo van begins to sway terribly in the wind, violently back and forth down the desert floor. Terrible, terrible. We didn't know what the hell was going on. Next thing we know, the tire shreds. Boom! Just like that. So one of our 12 vans is now totally kaput because the tire shredded. So after that happened... Oh, dear. After that happened... Well, that we were down one. Now we're down to 11 trucks.
Well, we were in the middle of the desert.
That's correct. Oh, I forgot about the man with the little...
Well, and don't forget that we started out... driving into the middle. Well, we started on this road trip without a jack.
That's right. Yeah, I think, Bob, you're just going to have to turn down a little bit because you are so loud. Turn your mat. Someone turn that guy down. I can't hear a thing in here. Oh, hell.
It doesn't matter.
Well, anyway, we'll just persevere even though we can't hear a darn thing we're saying. So, anyway... Yes, we didn't have a jack, did we?
No, we didn't have a jack.
Now, whose fault do you think that was?
Is that
Pastor Dick?
I think it was Pastor Dick.
Oh. It doesn't matter.
It's not...
It's only a...
He doesn't know jack about jack.
There's a technical difficulty. Oh, it wasn't you playing anything at all.
Crosley, were you doing all the electronic sound?
What's that? No, that's you.
What's Bob gesturing about?
I don't know. He's waving his hands in the air and frantically. It's a good thing he's in a hermetically sealed plastic bubble. I might have to come in there and... Oh, hell.
It's only a show.
Okay, we'll just go on. Everything's a lot calmer now. Everything, we've gotten through that now. We didn't have a tire jack. It was somebody's fault. And thank goodness the Nevada Department of Transportation just happened to drive by right at that moment. And a nice man with a handlebar mustache loosened the nuts. Our nuts. And then he got to... Oh, dear. And that leads us to Elko, Nevada. And I'm sure Tara will tell you all about Elko, Nevada.
We now love Elko, Nevada is our base.
Home away from home.
For Negative B Land.
And I thought, oh, this is terrible. This is boring.
We found a mechanic.
Yeah.
Juanita.
Yeah, Juanita and her nice husband. They're at H&H H&H Service. H&H Service right down there in Elko, Nevada. We're going to give them a little plug. They were very nice.
Oh, you forgot to mention that not only was the van swaying from side to side, dangerously fishtailing, but also we lost steering on the van at the exact same time.
That's right. For our steering, you turn the wheel to the right and the van goes to the left. And it did that for 50 godforsaken miles.
We thought maybe it was suspension problems.
Well, and it was.
It was. It but was. Also,
we not only that, but the people in the expensive tires that I mentioned before, well, they had put the wrong tires on the car, and they'd made the sway even worse. So, that, as you could see, they really had it out for Negative Land all the way down the line. They were ready to do it to us.
Excuse me, Velma. Have we gotten to the strip joint yet?
We're still on day three,
all
but
right.
I'm going to go a little
two.
Faster. No, that's day.
Okay.
No, that's day
okay.
three. Because okay, so we got out of Elko.
It's all true.
We got out of Elko, got everything fixed.
No, okay.
And immediately, less than a mile out of town, at freeway speed, all jubilant in our family radios. Lo and behold, the problem starts again. Car swaying back and forth, can't do a thing. Terrible. Had to turn around, go back to Elko. Now we're down to 9 vans.
What
from
time
12.
Was it?
Oh. 6 o'clock? No, 5 o'clock, right? Several garages later, we got our problems fixed a second time and got out again. And finally, we were out of Elko, Nevada. And I don't ever want to go back to Elko, Nevada ever again.
What time was it?
And we got out of there as soon as possible.
Just a moment, Velma. We must pause here for station identification. We'll continue with the exciting story of the Negative Lily Land. A True False 2000 tour across America. It's been so exciting, and you haven't heard half of it yet. I'll tell you, you're goddamn lucky to be... here, aren't we? Because we have had so many mishaps. This is WNUR in Evanston, Illinois. And we have...
WNUR.
How many shows have we played so far?
Last night was our fourth concert.
Only 4
out of 28.
28 to go.
Could you believe this could all have happened in the first week?
Yes, and unbelievable. They're still telling you stories of mishaps before even the first show. Is that right, Velma?
That's right. And
so we had to drive all the way across several states and just ran into it's pure hell out there, folks.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've been in a car lately.
Don't ever get into a vehicle. It's a very bad idea.
Those highways are very, very dangerous. The other members of our vast Negatively Land crew here, and there's Harold Camping walking by. Harold!
I'll go get him. Hold on.
Just a moment. He can jump in and finish the story. Velma is actually drooling at this point. We've gotten very little sleep. That's the problem with breakdown, folks. You know, you book a tour, you try to make as much money as you can to support your meager existence as a, well, whatever it is you call this.
Am I on the air?
Yes, here's Harold Camping. He'll continue with his story, but first I want to introduce Harold Camping of Family Radio.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
And Harold will be right with you as soon as I tell you about Harold Camping, who is... What? I guess I'm repeating myself. We haven't had any sleep in, what, a week? Week or two?
10 days.
10 days without sleep. I you may wonder, how can we do shows? How can we get on stage and play music and entertain the public?
You can.
With no sleep at all. And not to speak of good food. That's been a real problem, good food. Not the good food, that's no problem, it's just that we can't find it.
That's right. Say, listen, maybe you ought to read the phone number on the air. We'll take our first call.
All right, Harold, I'll do that as soon as I can figure out what I did with it. Do you have one?
I do. If you want to call...
If you could write that down for me on a little piece of paper right now, I'm being shown the back of a hand.
If you wish to be a part of the family radio conversation here...
Harold, just a moment, I have the number, 491-2231. And if you're calling from out of state, that's area code...
That's not correct. It's actually 847-491-2235.
I see, I've been given the wrong hand.
Now I'm going to cross it out in my notes and write again, 2237.
Now, as I understand it, this phone will ring in the studio, and if it rings, I'll pick it up and we'll put you on the air.
That's right. If you want to be part of the Over the Edge mobile program on Family Radio WNUR, just dial 847. There comes
the phone
right now. Let's put them on the air.
A good hello. This is WNUR hosting the Negatively Land. We never did come up with a title, but go ahead.
You're on the air with Dr. Harold Camping.
Hold it. Everybody shut up for
everyone
a minute.
Everyone stop
to make sure
making
that we're
any
getting
sound.
This. Stop
shut up.
Noise.
Shut up. Everyone, please shut up. Who's going? Someone's making noise. Everyone's looking. Everyone's looking over.
Hello.
Hello.
Yes.
Yes, you're on the air. I'm just trying to figure out which parts are live here and which ones aren't. But go ahead. I think I have it under control now. Just kidding. Go ahead. Negatively land. Yes, no B.
Would you mind,
What? What did you say?
You're too quiet.
Is this the same Negative Land of its album from Negative Land?
Formally, yes, that's true. Formally, that was our new album.
I'd like to request Car Bomb.
We don't have any of our own
we're
music
not
here.
Taking requests
We're not
tonight.
Really interested in our own music. But we're very happy that other people are. We're sick of it, actually.
I'm going to try an experiment.
I said, we're sick of it, actually.
I don't think the caller can hear me.
Yes, that's a good idea.
And can you hear, by the way,
what's that?
Wow, this voice is really loud.
This is Carbine. This is Carbine. This is Carbine. This is Carbine. This is Carbine.
Can you hear Harold?
Oh, I'm back. I was just going to talk to Velma by the vending machine.
You'll have to come in here to speak on the phone and simply won't go through the lights.
Well, that's too complicated. I've never been here. I don't know how to get through that door.
Do you know who Harold Camping is?
No, I don't.
Who are you calling, please?
I'm calling Negatively Land.
Oh, that's right. And you've never heard of Harold Camping?
No, I haven't.
Family Radio? Very well known.
Oh, that's right. Is he an NPR guy?
Bob, are you doing those samples of the dialogue that we're currently engaged in?
He's attempting to subvert everything. I have an idea. May I interject? Please tell the caller to hold on.
All right. Wait, I can relay a question.
Exactly. Would caller, are you near? You must be near your radio, are you not?
Are you near your radio? Hello?
Yes. Right, I'm in the same room as the radio.
And do you have headphones?
No, I don't.
Oh, God.
How can you not have headphones?
They're not plugged in.
Well, would you plug them into your radio, please?
Okay.
All right.
That will be your telephone.
Lower the telephone and speak into the mouthpiece like a microphone. Are you doing that?
You know he's not going to know what you mean by lower the telephone.
This is receptacle programming procedure that we follow out in California on Over the Edge, and I have to sort of educate them on how to do receptacle programming.
You're doing a good job educating the ignorant.
And so are you doing that now?
Yes.
Okay, so you can hear the whole show in your head, right?
Yes.
And you're using the telephone as a microphone, right?
Yes.
Excellent, excellent. Now, if you have a question for Harold, I will relay that question to him since he cannot hear you in his headphones.
Okay.
Harold is now gesturing to me in an obscene manner. I do not know what he means. As you can imagine, the technical difficulties.
No, I'm going to suggest that if you just move the microphone away from your mouth, you can now speak it very good.
Couldn't you hear me in the mic?
It's doubled up. Now you sound clear.
What do you mean by that, Harold? Doubled up?
If you're speaking into the microphone as well as the phone microphone, I am hearing you multiple times under modulation noise.
I understand that, Harold, but here's the problem on my end. He doesn't hear my microphone.
Why not?
Oh, wait, he has his headphones. Oh, I forgot. I just told him to put your headphones on.
And you still
have those headphones on. Now, I'm going to put down the phone, and you should be able to hear me in your headphones. Now, can you hear me? Hello? Hello? Are you there? Who are you calling?
What if he's messing with you?
May I help you?
Yes. What? I'm calling about Ingram Marshall, Bay Area musician.
Yes.
Ingram Marshall's not from the Bay Area, sir. You're a little...
Just a moment, please. Just a moment. We'll get to that. First, I want to clear this up. Do you still have your headphones on? I wish Bob would stop that sampling. It's driving me insane. Who is doing that? Who is doing the sampling of the show? I want an answer, and I want it now.
He's just April Fool's Day every day.
Who is doing that? Is it being done in the other studio? Hello?
Yes.
What? No, not you. You just stay put. Keep your headphones on and don't move. Are you getting hungry?
To make it all that noise.
Well, just try and find some good food in this town. My God, what...
Yeah, it's not like anybody around here knows how to eat. I haven't seen one restaurant yet.
What? Okay, was it that thing? No, don't do that. That was driving me insane, wasn't it, Harold? I'm sorry. We're a little discombobulated here. As I mentioned before, we haven't had any sleep in over 11 days. Done four shows, broke over three cars now, isn't it? And, all right, are you still there?
Yes, sir.
Thank you for hanging on. You're very patient, and I appreciate it. Now, I'm going to try this once more, and if it doesn't work, I'm going to hang up on you, so you better get it right.
I'm sorry?
All right?
Yeah.
And I'm going to put the phone down and talk into the microphone. You should hear...
If you're hearing under headphones, you're hearing me now. Are you hearing me now? It's not working.
No, it's still there.
Hello?
Hello? There's a delay on everything that's being said. What is that?
Oh, are we in a delay-type mode?
I have no explanation for that.
We don't want a delay. Caller, can you hear me now? You see?
Is there a delay on the phone?
Let's see. 5, 6, 7 second delay. Six.
I see. That's terrible.
Okay.
That's a radio station should not do
but
that.
But my understanding is that the delay was switchable.
It's not actually a...
The general manager is going to go tip over the snack machine.
All right.
And be sure that
here's
he fixes that problem with the delay.
Here's the technical problem.
While you're at it, get me a Twizzlers.
Or a wiener. A wiener. What was that? Wiener.
Oh, the wiener circle.
Harold,
do you all know about the wiener circle?
Harold
here?
Was down there this morning having breakfast. Go ahead, Harold. Tell him about the wiener circle.
Well, I can't do that on the air. That would be very bad.
Oh, just a moment, Harold. Let me interrupt you. We still have someone on the line here with a question. Are you still there, sir? And you still have your headphones on. Excellent. Now, I still want to try this. I'm going to put down the phone. I'm talking into the phone right now, and I'd rather talk into the microphone if you can hear me there, all right? So what I'm going to do is put down the phone and talk to you in the microphone. And if you can hear me, you say, I can hear you, all right?
Okay.
All right, here we go. Can you hear me?
I can barely hear you.
Oh, good. Hang on.
There's only one problem with this whole series.
Yes, what is it?
If there was a delay on him,
yes,
then you would be hearing him in your headphones wrong than you're hearing him on the telephone. If there was really a delay, you would never have been able to have that conversation. Am I
you're
right?
You're saying, Harold, that the delay is a deception?
I'm saying...
On the part of the station here?
Until they go and tip over that snack machine, that delay is going to be in place... And I'm going to lodge a complaint with the FCC.
All right. On the phone? Hello? Hello? Are you still there?
Play him Car Bomb, and maybe he'll start talking.
So much... Yes. Can you hear me now?
I can hear you a little bit.
You can't hear me very well.
It's
probably the incessant noise that's plaguing us right now. Hang on just a moment. Oh, my God. Holy my. Unbelievable.
All my years of broadcasting, I've never had such an onslaught of that kind of thing. Who was making all the sound?
Isn't this a relief now? Just nice and quiet. Now we can speak in a civilized
manner. Now we can sleep for the first time in 10 days.
Now, caller, can you hear me a little better?
Yeah, I no.
What?
I can hear you.
You can't hear me, but not very well. I'm speaking quite loudly into the mic. All right, I'll hold the phone close, too, so you can hear me. Now, Harold, you can hear him?
Very well.
All right, we can hear you very well. Why can't you hear us, sir?
I'm not sure.
Do you have your
headphones
on?
That reminds me of Dick Goodbody, who's with us on this tour, too, under the guise of Pastor Dick.
Oh, yes, it's our used car salesman, Dick Goodbody, who's come along. In fact, he provided us with all 12 of the vehicles that we're operating right now.
Unfortunately.
Unfortunately, you might say he's an anachronism. Now, why isn't that caller still talking?
He's still there. He's just waiting for someone to make some sense.
All right. I think it would behoove all of us if we did have a slight sound bed under there, however, because although the other one was very overbearing and I felt like I was trying to rest under the overpass, I think that it might be slightly better to have at least some sort of... That's awfully nice.
I have the young Japanese children singing right now.
Well, that's good.
Is that all right?
That's all right. All right, so we're going to move on. I guess it's time to get back to the tour diary. We probably don't
Harold,
have...
No, Harold, no, sorry, it isn't. This gentleman on the phone had a question for you.
Oh.
So go ahead
you're
now.
You're on the air with Dr. Harold Camping.
If you can hear us.
How you doing, Doctor? Thanks for taking my call.
Well, you're loud and clear.
You're very welcome, loud and clear.
You're overmodulated, in fact.
Well, I was inquiring about the Bay Area musician, Ingram Marshall, but you informed me he wasn't a
no,
Bay Area...
I believe Ingram Marshall,
where does he hail?
I think he is from the Los Angeles area. He performed in the Bay Area in November of 1999, I believe, or 98, and that is about all. And he's old. He's very, very old. In fact, he conducts, you're still on mic there, Crosley. Okay, well, anyway, we'll just go on as if this wasn't happening. What else would you like to know? This isn't really a music forum. It's more of a family radio talk show program. Mm-hmm.
What else would I like to know about Ingram?
No, about just about anything else.
Well, which of the main world religions will grab hold and dominate in the next century?
Well, as any of you would know from reading my tome entitled 1999, it was at that time that Jesus was going to return to the earth. I actually had a date that I predicted that would occur. It did not occur. I've been made somewhat of a fool of. I was mistaken. But in fact, it was a publishing error. It was a printing error. It really was not something that could be pinned to myself and my data processing unit. The printer made the error, and in fact, we will see the rebirth of He coming to us. At a date I will disclose later. Does that answer your question?
Now, do you hear that repeat?
Yes, it does.
All right, and shall we go on to our... No, we can't do next calls. This isn't Over the Edge in Berkeley, California, because we only have one phone line going on here. Well, we're just having technical difficulties again, and Crosley's coming back to say, please don't repeat anything that Crosley ever says.
Hello.
Ever.
Come on. are getting involved with you, where we're getting involved with you.
The countdown will begin this Sunday afternoon at 2, right here on WKRM 1340, where we're getting involved with you. The countdown will begin this afternoon at 2, right here on WKRM 1340, where we're getting involved with you. You're listening to American Top 40 on WKRM 1340, where we're getting involved with you. Yeah.
I had to stop drinking alcohol because I used to wake up nude in my car with my keys in my head.
Dying sucks. Oh God, it's over!
Don't suck. Just joy to you.
K-B-P-I.
Non-stop solid rock.
It's my hunch that if we were to auction the broadcast spectrum without the free ride that such programming now gets, the market and consumers would not demand 184 channels of Howard Stern.
Now dance, embrace a happy mood. Ah, enhance, delightfully improved.
Making for-profit TV pay for its spectrum and compete with other high-tech demands for spectrum would be a far better way of dealing with the problem of indecent programming than government regulation of speech.
You really want to know about the process.
Gentlemen, for the time. The big question on this bill is why now? There are enough laws in place and regulations to deal with this issue. I feel that some of the good, well-intentioned members have been caught up in this desire to all of a sudden clear up the airwaves. I believe it is a distraction. It is a weapon of mass distraction to keep us away from the real issues at hand.
Somebody's asking me a big question, right? You want to know the process.
The fact is that this is part, in my opinion, of the continuing thinking of the Patriot Act, the philosophy of the Patriot Act, that says we'll read your emails, we will find out what you take out from the library, we will hold you in detention without charges or lawyer, and we will then tell you what you can listen to on the radio. Now let's understand something. The target here is coming from the political and religious right, and it is directed only at that which they think is bad, anti-American, or indecent. Right-wing radio, which demonizes liberals, minorities, environmentalists, pro-choice, and animal rights activists, and they are fine. They will not be touched. And let me, for the record, say that I support their right to say whatever they want about me and other liberals and Democrats and minorities. They can say whatever they want. But what we're doing in this country is curtailing only people who are saying something else. The main target these days is Howard Stern. Now, what does Howard Stern have to do with this issue and the political agenda? Well, for years, He supported the administration on the war. He supported the administration on capital punishment. He supported the administration on just about everything. And in the last couple of months, he's had a change of heart and started opposing the war, started opposing the opposition to research, opposing the opposition to pro-choice. And all of a sudden, he's in deeper trouble than he's ever been before.
Process is the product. In 1966, the process began. It's been hiding away. It's been hiding away so long.
How else can we explain that the day before his bosses, Clear Channel, were to face a congressional committee, they fired him from six markets throughout this country? The FCC has been complaining about his lack of humor jokes for years. Some people have suggested that he was not in good taste for years. But now the big bang to get him off the air, and he's left now on Infinity Radio, and he says he will be gone in about another 2 weeks. Why? Was he okay when he was supporting the administration and trouble? And how did Clear Channel decide to knock out its number one moneymaker one day before facing Congress? I wish I was the telephone company and could have heard those phone calls coming in with the political pressure. My friends, this is a dangerous time. This bill should be defeated, if for no other reason to send a message that there is something larger here at work than simply something you don't like. What I don't like may be something you like and vice versa. The best protection we have is not this bill. Just turn the channel, switch the station.
He knows that when the fines do come, they are an affordable cost of business for Infinity.
This
basically, Howard Stern knows that, at least historically, he's had nothing to fear. Now, whether things are going to change, I hope so, but it still remains to be
rules?
Seen.
Robert, you want to answer? Okay, go ahead, Chuck.
What are the rules? Tell me the rules. Because nobody knows what the rules are. You just said the rules.
There's been a law on the books. It's called the Broadcast Indecency Law that was passed by Congress in 1927.
That's It was upheld by the Supreme Court in 1978,
and it has been enforced at least sporadically since 1987 or 1988 in recent history.
Listening to rules.
You violate the broadcast indecency law if you depict or describe in patently offensive terms sexual or excretory activities or organs. That's the legal definition. There's a long history of enforcement.
Does Howard Stern cross those lines?
No, absolutely not. This guy is doing what everybody else is doing right now. They're looking for damage control due to the fact that Janet Jackson cannot rely on her talent anymore and she flashes her boob.
Across the room, say I look nice when I'm not.
It's no different than Madonna, who makes out with Britney Spears on MTV. They're utilizing the forums in the wrong way. Now let me speak.
Touch my hair as you pass my chair. Little things, me.
The bottom line is this.
The FCC's been sitting on their butt for the past 6 years. Where were you guys for 6 years while Stern was saying the N-word and using other words and everything else? Nowhere. You guys were sitting around enjoying yourselves.
So
all of a sudden, Janet Jackson comes out, flashes a boob because the music no longer holds up. Well, Stern is the only one who's consistently doing edgy material, so you're going after him. That's the truth.
Personally, I don't think Janet Jackson, the incident, is the primary reason Clearwater did what it did. You know, you forget that
Janet Jackson.
Forget that the FCC fined Clearwater for the Bubble Love Sponge program, the largest fine that's ever been issued. Clearwater fired Bubble Love Sponge, period. He's gone. Now, intervening between that firing and Janet Jackson, Howard Stern gets bumped from I read Clearwater as saying, we don't want to be in the radio shock business any longer. I hope that's what they're doing.
What about,
obviously, Infinity is still in the radio shock business.
Wait a second.
I'm saying goodbye to you now.
These are the last shows.
These are the last days of Pompeii.
Listen to us now.
Boom, boom, boom.
Despite a constitution that said separate religion from state, it's not happening anymore. They control the media, Clear Channel, Fox, all of them. Korn sent over their latest video, can't get played. They're angry, and I get it. I believe that young people, 18, 16, 20, are freaking out right now.
Shock Jock Howard Stern, a casualty of a crackdown on indecency.
What's going on today? We got a breakaway. We got a problem, and I think it's gonna make us go down. They think we're all the same, and always here to play. For this, I think it's lame.
Harry, Howard, sorry, so sorry to call you so early. You know what, I'm going to leave my phone on, and in case you get this message, I'm going to get dressed and go into the radio station early. I want to try and put together a show where I don't talk and take all of these newscasts of things and just make that, and all of the congressmen testifying and everything. I was actually calling to get your help, and I know it's really early in the morning, but it's just one of those rare instances where I think we have to put together a special show. Because they're really f***ing with us. So, you know, I'm going to go in early. I'm going to start getting ready. If you get this message for any reason, and you can, like, throw on some clothes and get in. Maybe, hopefully, Scott, the engineer, will be there on time, and I can start working with him. I'm going to give it a shot. Okay. Thanks. Call me. I'll put my phone back on.
Hey, Howard, I'm listening to your radio right now. You sound a little low. Just want you to know that I love you. You're the best. I listen to K-Rock every day, and you make me happy every time I listen to your show. You keep doing what you're doing. Don't leave. We all love you. You got a lot of fans out there.
What about just turning the dial? Are you for censorship? Yes or no?
Well,
are
you know, interestingly, in that 19...
Yes or no,
well, I tell
question.
You.
Are you for censorship?
In the 19...
He's not answering. It's yes.
Well, you are giving me an option
yes
to
or
answer.
No. It's yes or
I'll
no.
Roll with it.
First, Howard Stern, we were just talking earlier in the show about how yesterday we were talking about how it might be a little bit melodramatic for him to say that he's very close to getting pulled off the air. And, you know, again, I'm a big fan. I apologize to Mr. Stern. He may be right. The FCC, apparently, according to the Wall Street Journal, is going after, they've got about a dozen cases that are being quote-unquote finalized, and they're going after shock jocks, and the big target obviously would be Howard Stern. He's wildly successful. He's made a lot of money. He's been on the air for how many years?
Oh,
and now they're going to start going after him.
Yeah, doing the same stuff for 20 years, and you know where to find him on the dial, so just don't
and
go
you know,
there.
And you know what his deal is all about.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah, but this is not the first time he's been fined. But I think the FCC, Michael Powell, I think, is spearheading this effort. But they're also bowing to a lot of public pressure to clean up the airwaves. I guess a lot of this after the Janet Jackson fiasco during the Super Bowl.
I'm just wondering how much public pressure, though. I mean,
well, a lot of people apparently are upset with what they're hearing on the air, what they're hearing and what they're seeing both on radio and TV. I mean, you know, vulgarity has gone... come to new heights in terms of the amount of profanity that's been
used. Howard Stern has been around for a long time, and you know, like, he...
Give me your arm as we cross the street. Call me at 6 on the dot. A line a day when you're far away. Little thing.
In the Supreme Court decision, they held specifically that enforcing the broadcast indecency law is not censorship in terms of the legal meaning of that
question.
Word.
Are you
a lawyer?
Sal,
I am.
Jay brought it up before in the earlier segment.
Can we speak, Chauncey, for the love of God?
Is this a cultural war? Is a cultural war going on here? As far as vulgar, I mean, I have to say the guy, he's non-politically correct, and I think that fires a lot of people up. You know, he doesn't bow to the PC.
Right. You know, I was talking to one of our folks here at the station. They're saying, you know, they listen to Howard Stern. And then this is, and once again, this is a matter of what you like to listen to and what you don't. It's a matter of taste. It's- Every time I turn on Howard Stern, after I kind of turn him off, I feel so depressed because he's always attacking somebody.
A lot of Howard Stern is joking and it's sarcasm.
It's a lot of goofy stuff, TNA and stuff like that. Yeah. But some people say he's being attacked. People think he's a racist. Well, if you listen to the guy over the years, there's absolutely no way that he's a racist.
Yeah, he brings I think that he is.
You know, in certain
aspects. Julian,
certain
are you serious?
Yeah.
He brings on the guy from the KKK and has him as a regular guest because he just
makes fun of him.
There are people that are called equal opportunity bigots. I mean, you know, he could be going around the dial on that. So I don't know.
I think you really have to listen.
Yeah.
A lot.
Yeah.
To figure out that he's not.
Yeah.
Here's the issue. FCC's looking for damage control. They look like a bunch of morons. They've been sitting on their butt. And what are they going to do? They're going to find somebody who's consistently edgy. Janet Jackson went back to her mansion to live up her good life as her brother allegedly is molesting children. Allegedly. Okay? People go back to their lifestyle. Stern, this is his livelihood. This is his business. He's an easy target. The FCC knows he's going to be racy. They're on top of him. But he's complying.
Put him on after midnight. I'm not trying to get him off the air. Because that's where he belongs.
What? You're telling me when I should listen to see somebody? Why don't I go to your home and tell you what you should watch?
You know what you're the...
Why don't I go to your home? I tell you what. Why don't you put on Lawrence Welk after
midnight? He's just saying, though, he doesn't want him off the air.
It's got to do with the nuisance concept. The nuisance concept doesn't say that a pig is a bad thing. It says that a pig belongs in a barnyard, not in the parlor.
And it's also in terms of freedom of speech. That's an issue here also.
Right.
For those who like him, I think he has every right to be on the air, though.
Well, there you go. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh.
Why?
That's the language of
this is the bottom line. The FCC should utilize Stern as an icon and as an example who abides by the rules and regulations of the FCC.
Okay, hang on. Last word, everybody.
You leaves after midnight.
He's an equal opportunity. I mean, the guy's got everybody from every aspect of life.
Yeah.
And, you know, if you can't joke about
that's right,
something.
I guess.
Don't have to buy me diamonds or pearls, champagne, sables, or such. I never cared much for diamonds and pearls, 'cause honestly, honey,
they just have money.
Listen, it's plain and simple. The show can come on at any hour. You turn the dial if you want to listen.
That's
monitor your own children.
Howard, don't wimp out, man. Dude, you're the only one who can speak to 18 million people. For 20 years, we've listened to you, and now you're going to cop out because you're getting some pressure for some sissy-ass, pansy-fag, pencil-pushing morons. F W Bush, F the administration, F the right, F the whole religious thing. Do your show, bring it back, don't wimp out, you owe us.
But baby, close your eyes. Feel my fingers walking over. Part of you idolized.
Monitor your own children. If you can't, you shouldn't have children. Well, I tell you,
go ahead, Robert. No,
come on. Well, I'm just saying, listen to me. I monitor my children. You know what? If my children happen to hear Howard Stern, at least they're saying the word penis and the other words that the other children are using in school. You know? That's the bottom line.
Hey, you getting drunk? So sorry. I've got you sussed.
What's up? Don't give up, man. George Bush's numbers are going down. John Kerry's numbers are starting to go up. If you're going to quit, wait till after the election. Do your best. I know it's tough, but come on, do the right thing. We got to get George Bush out of there. Talk to you later. Bye.
And I don't care. I have wonderful children. It's my job as a parent to parent my children, to police my children, to set, you know, if I feel something's wrong, it's my job. If a child says an F curse, if a child robs a bank, if a child does whatever the case may be, you can't blame somebody like
Howard. Let me ask you this. How about
that's ridiculous.
How about if your kid goes to an adult bookstore? Are you glad that
if my kid goes to an adult bookstore, you better buy me a book too.
Getting stronger, so soft on my cheek, getting longer. Give me your hand. No need to speak as I take you between my lips. When I've lost my way. All day long I've been planning on how I was going to love you tonight, so I could show you how I absolutely adore you.
Okay. Well, most parents
are... Keep it on target, yeah. People.
His numbers are going down since you started talking bad against them. They retired for a while.
Indecency on the airwaves is one of two big cultural issues that have boiled up this week.
So you know, I am your woman.
Most parents are very thankful that there are laws that prohibit
children from buying things at adult bookstores. Most parents are glad that they're getting some help from government. I don't think they want government to raise their children for them, but this nonsense that the only people in society that have any responsibility for raising the next generation of our society is parents is insane.
You feel so good.
The other, of course, is gay marriage.
And we've gathered three panelists for our Friday Mixer to talk about these controversial issues and much more. Lawrence O'Donnell is senior political analyst for MSNBC, and he joins us from L.A. MSNBC's Pat Buchanan is here in Washington, along with Republican Congressman Dave Dreyer of California, who is, of course, the chairman of the powerful House Rules Committee. Thanks so much for being with us. Let me start with you, Lawrence. This Washington attack on indecency, trying to regulate the airwaves, is this a good idea?
Well, if it's an attack, it's not a good idea. If it's trying to maintain standards in broadcast arenas that have traditionally been controlled by that, then it makes a certain sense. It has gone over the top already. The week after Janet Jackson's exposure, ER, NBC decided to cut out a scene where in the emergency room you saw for a billionth of a second a portion of an 80-year-old breast on a woman who was being pulled in for emergency surgery. In ER, over the 10 years of the show, they've shown all sorts of different body parts in different angles for seconds here and there in the rush of the action and all that, and no one's ever complained about it before.
This is How Radio Isn't Done, Part 4, tonight on Over the Edge, and we're going 5 hours tonight till 5 a.m. This is KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, kpfa.org.
Give me your shoulder.
Give me your shoulder to cry on.
Have you ever listened to the Howard Stern Show?
To Atlanta, and I'm tired of all my CDs. So I asked somebody, where can a guy find new rock and roll? New rock and roll. And they pointed me to the so-called new music station. But all I heard was a bunch of whiny, granola-eating, electricity-impaired, bubblegum Athens wannabe, tree-hugging, pansy music. That ain't rock and roll. Things were looking pretty rank, till I found this station. Play rock and roll, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Alice in Chains, Stone Temple Pilots, Bush, Metallica. Now that's new rock and roll.
Atlanta's rock and roll station.
Who's she?
96. Rock.
This is Y100.
Early in the morning.
There's a certain kind of overreaction going on. That will calm down after a while, and most everything will get back to normal.
Well, let's ask David Dreyer about that. Is Congress overreacting to this, and is it going to calm down after a while?
Because whether the day is bright or gray, do you feel so good?
Once per week, because somebody asked me to tape it, and that was probably 10 years ago.
And what did he say that offended you?
Was it your child?
Well, okay, some of it was funny, and some of it crossed the line. And if Howard Stern wants to stay on the air,
your standards,
he can stay funny, but he can still
conform to your standards of comedy.
I feel
community standards.
I feel like I'm talking to my high school principal. We're adults. This is pathetic.
Please give me your heart.
Well, I know that a lot of people were very angry following the Super Bowl. I was surprised. And the thing that really offended me was the prospect of a 5, 6, 7, 8-year-old child watching the Super Bowl. And that entire halftime program was pretty raunchy.
Send me the words of a secret smile. You feel so good. Show me you haven't forgot.
Thanks, Al, Robert. It was quite entertaining playing referee.
Thanks,
over
Janet.
Here.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks for
Thank
coming
you for
in.
Having us.
Tuesday, the Senate Commerce Committee voted to increase the maximum fine for indecent programming from $27,500 to $500,000.
You'll get fired for your remarks. You can't discuss girls' body parts.
Run your fingers through my hair as you force my mouth to open. Always and ever, now and forever.
To see that today, after a firestorm of public criticism, that we have an increasing appetite both in Congress and the FCC for punishing those who repeatedly flout the rules.
Don't judge, I love it there as I drink it deep inside.
And we have before us a strong measure. One, it'll boost the maximum fine to $500,000, make it easier for the FCC to fine performers rather than just their employers, and threaten to strip licenses of repeat offenders.
I can feel all your strength. What would you like me to do?
I should also point out, both before and after the Super Bowl instance, my office received over 500 emails from my district concerning indecent broadcasts. And I'd like to share the message of just one of those constituents, and I quote, "I'm very glad to see that you're taking action to protect our kids from indecent, profane, vulgar, and tasteless programming."
I'll take you inch by inch. Just let me worship you. Fill me up so deep, you're touching my soul.
Just when I thought the TV couldn't get worse, I witnessed the appalling display at the halftime show of the Super Bowl. My 11-year-old son and 15-year-old daughter were speechless. Please know I'm behind you 100%, and I hope this bill will strengthen the power of the FCC and allow them to penalize those sponsors.
I mean, you can see it late night on MTV or someplace else. And so that really created a level of anger among my colleagues. I think Lawrence is right that this will calm down. And one of the things that I always believe we need to be careful with is we need to be very careful in doing anything that undermines the First Amendment to the Constitution. We want freedom of expression. I come from Los Angeles. I'm a lone Republican who represents the Hollywood area. And I don't want to in any way jeopardize that right to expression. But I do think that it's correct. They're public airwaves, and I think that at least some kind of warning, which has been utilized in the past, is appropriate when these kinds of programs are going to happen.
I have seen it all, man. Yesterday's vote was chilling.
absurd, disappointing.
I think the American people have had enough of costume reveals and wardrobe malfunctions, and I urge passage of the bill.
Never, Mr. Chairman, would I have thought that defending the Constitution would be so lonely a job.
Chilling, absurd, disappointing, and the end of free speech. Really the end. This country's nuts, and George W. Bush has to go.
On the floor of the United States House of Representatives. Don't get me wrong. I believe in decency. I believe in Mary Poppins. I believe in all things nice. But what's at stake here is freedom of speech and the assault thereon. I become more and more concerned about the concentration of the media in the hands of so few players. That kind of media power concentrated in the hands of so few.
If you're a fan of mine and I reach millions of people, just get them out of office. Your rights are being taken away. This guy's insane. I'm not just talking about me and free speech. I'm talking about everything. The arguments are absurd. I am not a racist. I was watching TV last night. Bill O'Reilly comes on, a guy who has personally sat me down and said, I want to thank you, because if it wasn't for you, there wouldn't be me. And that's the absolute truth.
He certainly came on this show and said it.
Yeah.
And then, hawk his book.
And then got on the air last night and said how he was for indecency fines. And of course he is, because once I'm off the air, these guys are going to pretend to you that they're innovative, that they're artists,
and that they have figured this all out by themselves.
That they have original thought.
You taste so good. You taste so good.
Bill O'Reilly's got no original thought. He's a liar. He lies to my face. He's two-faced. And he's a puppet of the right-wing administration of George Bush.
I remember him once saying, Howard, you and I are alike. We're like the same kind of guy.
Yeah. No, we're not, dude. We're totally different. Here's the difference between us. I'm an original. You know as well as I do, when I got into radio, news guys didn't even give their opinions on the radio.
They were supposed to have any.
Yesterday on CNBC, I'm watching some dude who... they mention my name, he starts giving a big thumbs down, one of the newscasters, and I'm going, boy, when would you ever see a newscaster express an opinion with thumbs down before I got on the radio? I've changed broadcasting because, let me tell you something, all this stuff against gays, Bill O'Reilly probably has, you know, gay people doing his makeup, probably has, you know, gay people have created the arts in this country, and all the things that we enjoy. And this guy sits there and talks about taking their freedoms away. George W. Bush, a guy who probably enjoys a lot of good things in America created by gay people, and he puts them down and he squashes their creativity. And let me tell you something, he's got to go.
And influenced specifically by the far right wing and religious right in this country. We talk about the president and the presidency, and we say that the president has a bully pulpit, and he does. That doesn't concern me. What concerns me is the bullyism and the bullying that's going on, where networks and stations and people who own media are afraid to be critical of the administration, to impose a fine on speech that you don't like. Of $500,000 a shot, multiplied by 30 or 300 stations, doesn't have a chilling effect. It has a freezing out effect, where people will be afraid to speak out. It's not for us to put limits on free speech. The public decides what they want to listen to and wants to hear.
Howard Stern is political enemy number one. Stand up for Stern before someone says you can't.
Stern should be allowed to say what he wants and screw Bush.
The only ones with the balls to even play him, and now we're having that taken away.
And it's the same with me. When I got into radio, it was a wasteland. People playing records, news guys not giving opinions. I got on the air and I changed it.
Little thing, me.
The system. And the reason there are freedoms on the air today is because of what I did. Period. End of sentence.
You made a powerful medium. It was nothing. Nothing.
I fought everyone who ever said to me, you can't do what you're doing on the air.
Howard Stern.
Call now and voice your opinion. 889-KXTE.
This is a sham. The FCC is a government office that literally was about to close down, and this has made them relevant.
Freedom becomes free dumb.
I've been fighting it for 25 years, so jerk-offs like Bill O'Reilly, Rush Limbaugh, and the whole lot of them can get on the air and have a party.
You taste so
good. And I'm all for it, and I'm all for speech, but remember who got you there.
I want to lick. I want to suck. I want to hug. I want to squeeze. I want to nibble. Scream. I want to make you the happiest man alive. I want you deep in my throat. I want to smell your sweat. I want to lap up your mouth. Give me some. My mouth is a hole. Fuck me.
It's not the guys who didn't take risk. It's the guys who are on the front lines.
I don't know how many more days I have on the air.
And all sit idly by and talk about how wonderful it is that a $500,000 fine per offense, an offense we don't even know what they're talking about, where Chairman Powell gets to decide what's offensive to him, and then they fine me personally.
Oh, darkness, my old friend.
Should Howard Stern be booted off the air?
Well, I think what Howard Stern should do is not air indecent material. I don't think he has to be booted off the air, but if he continues to break the law, then those stations are in danger of losing their licenses.
Sound of Stern's silence is a death rattle for free speech.
F you.
Howard Stern. We let him break all the rules because he pays our rent.
You and your bill. Vote these jackoffs out of office now. Get rid of them. Get rid of them. Get rid of George W. Bush. He didn't even win the goddamn election and he's acting like he has a mandate. Just shut up, you creep. What a bum. With that smirk on his face everywhere he walks. He smirked when he bankrupted companies. He smirked when he won the election, when his brother handed it to him in Florida. He smirked when Clear Channel took me off the air in Florida, which is a swing state, and he's smirking all the way to the bank. Take him out of office, fire him. Get rid of him. It's time. It's time for him to go. Him and his right-wing religious nuts have completely taken over our culture. They want to shut me up. I'm the only one who even was brave enough to come on the air and do all this stuff.
Live 105. The fight continues.
The FCC.
FCC, this whole Howard Stern issue.
The debate rages on.
Clear Channel booting him off the six stations. He says that he thinks he's going to be fired from these stations. I mean, is this getting into a sticky situation?
Yeah. I think the government should not be interfering in this kind of thing.
I hate to agree with Howard on anything, but I agree.
They want to throw me out of the media. He's smirking. This is all about me going against him, and he told his Clear Channel buddy, get rid of Stern. Come on.
They are so afraid of me and what this show represents.
Forget that the FCC fined Clearwater for the Bubble Love Sponge program, the largest fine that's ever been issued.
Get the picture of what's going on here. This is scary. Not just for me, for the whole country. You're going to start finding individual broadcasters. Let me understand something. If you call into a talk show and you get heated up in an argument, you say the F word, they're going to come to your house, knock on your door, and fine you $500,000? That's what they're saying. Because you use the F word? Come on. This is a joke. What a double standard, too. They got dirty language all over the radio after 10 o'clock at night. What's the difference? That's when kids listen. Nobody's interested in protecting kids. You got the same nuts who are after me going after these gun laws where they only have to have a clearance check. You care about kids, why we want guns on the street? The hypocrisy is just oozing out of these slobs. I was laying in bed last night. I've been up since 3 just freaking out over this crap. I don't even know where to begin. This show is in big danger. It's in danger because I got news for you. You know, where the hell is Hillary Clinton? This is going to go in front of the Senate pass this bill. Where are they? What is going on?
That's the thing. Standing four square behind them, I think.
Yeah, that's the thing. They're hiding, too.
I don't see anybody. It's shocking to me. Broadcasters aren't speaking out.
Yeah.
But it's a shock to me. I mean, I would think that these people would be lining up outside my door coming on the air going, listen, this is an outrage. This is the Bush administration. This is the religious right hijacking the country. Bush didn't, you know, if I was Bush, I'd sit back and go, you know, remember, you didn't win the election. The majority of the people in this country didn't want you. Why are you trying to change our Constitution?
Philadelphia's new rock, Y100.
You don't even have a mandate. Are you insane? Get the mandate first, win this election big, and then go change things. At least get some people on your team. Man, oh man, this is nuts. You haven't seen one congressman after another, Republican and Democrat, getting up and talking about how we need more fines. Now, more speech has to be regulated. The only guys up there, Ackerman,
Serrano.
I think it was a. I knew the other guy's name.
Congressman Wiener.
Wiener. That's it.
Tell you, God bless those guys.
You know what it is?
There'd be no voice.
None of them want to get up because they're afraid they'll be called out for being against indecency. I haven't done a goddamn thing that's indecent ever in the history of my show. Prove that I'm indecent. Let me go to court. It won't. There's nothing indecent going on here. To decent, after 9/11, George W. Bush, what was the first thing he did? He got Osama bin Laden's relatives out of this country. Start reading. Talk and see his relationship with the Saudi Arabians and the rulers of Saudi Arabia. Start to read about this stuff. Gotta get this guy out of here. I'm telling you, he's dangerous. He's insane. I don't even think he's sane. He's talking to Jesus in the White House. I'm looking more and more at satellite radio. I think it's crap that I gotta go to satellite radio.
You're like Marconi again. You're back to nothing, and you're trying to figure out how to get on the air.
I've built up a business over 25 years, forming a relationship with my audience to the point that I have millions and millions of listeners. And if you think it was easy getting on in Los Angeles, syndicating in more, now you see all these shows syndicated.
Yeah, I couldn't trying even to convince people that it was possible.
Yeah, I mean, the fight to create what I've created on the radio has taken me years and years and years. And I got to tell you something. George Bush has never built a business in his life. He wouldn't know what I've gone through. He wouldn't know what it's like to come up the hard way. He wouldn't even know from where I grew up.
He's rooted for you.
Yeah.
But it's always been a bunch of people putting him at the head of something.
And let me tell you something. Most of these congressmen, and I hate to lump them all in one big lump sum, but they haven't created a thing of art. They haven't created an innovation. They haven't taken on the establishment, and they're pathetic worms.
They are the establishment. It's so sad that the people who grew up with us have now become the people we used to scream at.
People were dying under the rubble. George Bush was getting the bin Ladens to safety. That's not the right thing to do. I went on Chairman Powell, the head of the FCC's website, yesterday.
What's he up to now?
It's very disturbing. You should go on there and take a look at it. There's you click on one button, it says, meeting at the World Trade Center. And you got him there in his hard hat, and he's going through the rubble.
Oh, it's like a tourist event.
Yeah. And then right underneath, it's me with celebrities. Right? Talk about senseless and tasteless. His pics of himself, his fun pics. And by the way, you should see this website. It must cost millions to produce this website. You have to see it. I can't do that.
He and George Bush have a lot in common. You know, they're the two sons of
rich guys
who did something and are reaping the benefits. They don't know what they're up to.
Look, there's the photo gallery. And then when you click, you can have your World Trade Center pictures with him at the World Trade Center because he's down there because the antenna went down at the World Trade Center. And then right underneath that are fun pics with him and Aretha Franklin and Diana Ross. Come on, find me already. Let's get this charade over with.
Hey, you know, you were talking about the congressman before. You got to mention one guy's name. His name is Ron Paul from Texas. How could there be one Republican who doesn't think like the rest of the rest?
Yeah, he was the only one.
One Republican voted against that bill yesterday?
Yeah, one. Because George Bush tells his minions, go out and vote this way. Get Stern off the air. By the way, I was really shocked by O'Reilly last night. Congress is teaching Howard Stern a lesson. No, it's not Howard Stern. It's the radio industry. It's the broadcast industry that you're a part of, you jerk.
Go through and cut him again, just saying WKRM 1340.
Oh, fuck.
Paul's me at my house. I want you to come on my show. I want you to come on my show. I'm for you, man. Yeah, you're sure you are, dude.
You forget. This isn't about indecency. Where am I indecent? You're leaving out a big chunk of the story, you liar.
WIGY and WJTO. The countdown will begin this Saturday morning at 9 and again Sunday morning at 9 right here on Maine's most listened to radio station, W... I'm not going to say all that shit.
E cosa c'ha, Cardo? Cosa sta facendo? E cosa si sta spogliando?
No one has proven me obscene or indecent.
E perché si spoglia?
Anywhere. And then I saw one broadcaster slamming me that I'm up on racism charges. I'm like, well, where was I racist?
It's like people dancing on your grave before you can even get into it.
Yeah, I mean, isn't that slanderous? I'm a racist? Where was that? What, because the guy Clear Channel heard the word nigger on the air? The guy called in. I don't condone using the word nigger. I'm not going to hide it from the air. People use it. I hear it every day. Lenny Bruce used to say it in his act to make a point.
Well, that's what I thought we were doing.
Yeah, but anyone... you'd be branded a racist in this society.
Right. This society...
Because look, that's what we're into, branding, not really looking at the issues.
This cultural war is about the fact that George W. Bush wants to cut out anything that is artistic and different.
How do I know they're the most listened to station?
Oh, I'll take your word for it. Okay, drop it off and say right here on...
No, you know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
That's right. You're going to get some real great entertainment once they fix everything.
With these new laws... No one who bucks the system, no one who is different, will come into this medium. There is nobody that I know, including me, can afford to pay $500,000 to the government every time they think something is wrong. And let me tell you something. There'll be no young broadcasters who are going to come into this business and do things differently. It's going to just revert to bland, boring crap.
This affects television too. Don't expect your television to stay the same.
And people love television. People in this country love porno. Chilling. Absurd. Disappointing. And the end of free speech.
Countdown will begin this. The countdown will begin this Saturday morning at 9 and again Sunday morning at 9 right here on Radio Do. Oh, shit.
This is How Radio Isn't Done on Over the Edge tonight till 5 a.m. KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF, Fresno, KPFA.org.
Requirements have been implemented like we knew they should. Now dance, please dance, embrace a joyful mood. Substantially improve, substantially effectively, remarkably, considerably, definitely, certainly, very much improve.
Hello,
who's that?
It's Lizzie.
Hi, Lizzie.
Hi. Not just mice like cheese, gerbils like it too.
How interesting.
And it is lovely, and I cannot find any sort of replacement in England.
Dofino.
Spell that for me.
D-O-F-I-N-O.
Dofino.
So they call it queso de la casa, which is house cheese.
Yeah.
D-O-F-I-N-O.
And what does it taste like?
Well, it's very like a sort of a very creamy Edam.
Dofina.
It really is such a nice cheese. I can't think why no one's picked up on it over here, because it's beautiful for cooking. It's lovely in sandwiches.
Yes.
Medio kilo d'ofino, por favor.
Bon perfecto. Bye-bye.
Bye.
I'll do one more call because we're getting quite busy now. Then I must play that wonderful record. That's, do you know this one that goes like this? Nobody does it better. Do 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 do.
Hello.
Nobody does. Nobody does it better. Do 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 do.
Hello.
Hello, Jean.
Hello.
All right, on to our next caller then.
Mm-hmm.
Hello.
Who are you? You jumped up to it, Matthew. Yeah.
Anyway, thanks a lot.
Okay. All right. Hope it sorts out. Bye-bye.
Yeah. This is where I shall do my whoopsies, and you'll know that if you come in here, this is my house.
Oh.
No. No. No, bother.
All right, on to our next caller then.
Mm-hmm.
Hello.
What's your name?
Well, what I would suggest is that you put her feet into a salt bath.
Mm.
And
is it all the feet, Jean?
Yes, it's all the feet.
Yeah.
Just the feet, not up to the joints or anything.
No, that's right, just in between the toes. Mm.
Am I
calling them,
but I want to get the hell out of here.
Oh, God, it's moving right towards you.
You thought we weren't going to get your brains and twist them. But we will.
This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor.
Well, you know, we've discussed the UFO alien autopsy thing on this program so many times in the last few months. That tonight, but what I am going to discuss is something that occurred the other day. As a matter of fact, we can start by laying all the blame on Dwight's doorstep.
That's right.
Dwight called me up on Thursday morning and said, "You're not going to believe it. You're not going to believe what I heard early this morning on the Art Bell Show." And I said, "Well, you're right, because I was in bed. I was sleeping. What did you hear?" "You're not going to believe who is going to be on Bell's show tonight," which was Thursday. I said, "Okay, who?" He said, "Harley Bird." Now, Art Bell has a huge radio program. It goes coast to coast. During the week, I believe he's on something like 200 stations around the country. Something like that.
Something like 147, I think, or 148, somewhere. But maybe 200 by now.
A bunch.
Yeah. A bunch of radio stations. And Bell has been doing radio for a long time.
Can I say something? I am the one who made the call, and why I was panicked. I have been listening to Art Bell since I got a little satellite dish and put it up in Central California and picked him off the satellite, which is where he basically was being sent. He was using the satellite, and there was his name. And I think he was on a few AM stations, but I got him off the satellite. And Art Bell was an interesting mainstream personality on the radio. Conservative. He talked politics. He was very rational. And periodically, he talked about the subject of UFOs, but not in a derogatory sense. He looked at it critically and skeptically, but he did not laugh at people who had these experiences or at all of the stories surrounding the subject. It was not just an automatic laugh. He wanted to hear someone. But it was a small part of his program. He gave a little bit of respect to the subject, and to me that was interesting. And I have followed him ever since. When I heard that Harley Bird was going to be on, and I heard the little promo he gave about Harley Bird and the Hollow Earth theory, that this was something extraordinary, knowing what I know about Harley Bird, thanks to Russ and yourself, Mr. Ecker, it is not comprehensible to me that someone would put this man on the most listened to nighttime talk radio program without having completely and thoroughly researched.
Now, there probably are a lot of people tonight that are tuning in that do not know.
Well, they will find out tonight. But you will understand, I have always liked Art Bell. And I have found him a breath of fresh air. But this...
Well, ladies and gentlemen,
is destructive.
The reason this was such a shock, Russ Estes' first video that he put out with the UFO theme, which was Quality of the Messenger, involved a 14 or 13 part series that Russ has been working on. And as a result of this series, and he can tell you much more about it than I can, but he had traveled all over the country interviewing people in and without the field of ufology, of UFO research, in order to put this series together. And this individual, Harley Bird, was somebody that sought Russ out initially. Russ, in turn, got in touch with him. And Russ, why don't you go ahead and just very briefly lay the circumstances out of what transpired at that point.
Well, you have to understand, first off, from a journalistic point of view, Harley Andrew Bird is an interesting subject because of his claim to be a blood relation to a famous person, Admiral Richard Bird. So I certainly cannot fault anyone in the media for being attracted to Harley Bird, as I was. I know Vicky and UFO Magazine was attracted to him for the same reason long ago.
How attracted?
But of course...
I've seen pictures.
and so have I, and they're very interesting. But Harley Andrew Bird did say that he would sit for an interview with me.
Well, now, it always has him listed as the nephew of Admiral Richard Bird.
He has always claimed to be the nephew. I did interview Harley Bird. The interview really fell apart. He really made a fool of himself so horribly during the course of the interview that I really had to do an expose on the man. It was very easy to check into the background of Harley Bird. He claimed to be a relative of a famous man. During the course of the interview, he claimed to be the nephew of Admiral Richard Byrd. He claimed that his father, whose name was Leverett Byrd, was Richard Byrd's brother. He also claimed that he bounced on the knee of his grandfather, William Byrd, who, by the way, happens to be the grandfather of Richard Byrd and died in 1823, which would make Harley a rather old soul. So it might have been in a past life that he bounced on his knee. And in fact, by the way, his father's name is not Leverett Byrd. It is Everett Byrd. He lives in Ridgecrest. I talked with him, and he's no relationship to Richard Byrd. Harley Byrd really unraveled quite easily. The man claimed to be a lawyer, claimed to go to Harvard, claimed to go to UCLA, claimed to go to the Naval Academy, claimed to work at Lawrence Livermore Labs, claimed.
Not to mention a PhD.
Claimed. Absolutely. Of course, that PhD was a doctor given to him by the LA Press Club. Yes. So, here we have Dr. Harley A. Byrd, who, by the way, used to pass himself off as Stephen Boyd Jr., but you didn't hear that from me. Who also has a criminal record for indecent exposure, and you didn't hear that from me. But Harley Byrd is way, way, way over the edge. Way, way, way over the edge. Now we get back to the Art Bell Show. Way, way, way over the edge. Now, Dwight, you started this.
I know. Go ahead.
And you called Don.
Yes. And suggested that he call you.
And he did. And guess what I did?
You called Art.
Tell
him how.
You know, this is sad. I decided that Art Bell, I mean, I always had respect for Art Bell also, and I've never heard his show. Just off of the internet, I gained respect
and
for
him. And I want to say, the only reason I called Don about this and suggested that you contact him is because I have respected Art Bell. I mean, I did it literally hoping that he's being fooled here. He doesn't understand.
I understand.
That somebody would get to him. Now, tell the story.
And this is the very reason that as a fellow media person, I thought I would send him some information. I sent him a fax, a 10-page fax, with some basic information that we had gathered on Harley Bird. My cover letter was not even completely through the fax machine when Art Bell called me. Right off the bat, he was confrontational, and he was adversarial. So I send a lot of this information to Art Bell. He gets on the phone, and he jumps down my throat. How do you know these things?
You're faxing him. He calls you before you finish faxing.
Before I'm finished faxing him, and he jumps down my throat immediately. How do you know this? How do I know this? Because I've been researching it, because I did these tapes. These things are from 1992, because I've interviewed the man, because I've checked his complete background. I've got the genealogy from the Mormons. I mean, you know, you got it from the Mormons, you know it's right. I mean, I've got the census from the turn of the century. I've got everything on the Byrd family. And then I said to him, and I even talked to Byrd's father. Well, do you have a written statement from his father? What written statement from his father? I don't need a written statement from his father. Of course, I did tape the conversation from his father. His father lived in Ridgecrest at the time. His father was very old. And his father said, Harley's had a problem with this all of his life. I told all these things to Art Bell. And over the course of the day, Art Bell called me 4 times.
He wanted to call me, didn't he?
He wanted to get in touch with you because he knew you were a target of Harley Bird's ire. We've received... And that's
speaking of that, I have sitting right here in front of me, because I brought it all, and I, as a matter of fact, one of the threatening telephone calls I got from Harley Andrew Byrd, a.k.a. Dr. Harley Byrd, I played for Dwight before the show.
Dwight is still laughing, by the way.
Where he's telling me he's got Uzis and Magnum pistols and he's coming to get me.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know.
And of course, he's Willie Brown.
And he's using a phone. I mean, he's using a very bad black dot.
Now, I would play that for the audience, but the problem is I don't have it bleeped.
Well, they wouldn't be able to hear it with all of the bleeps in it, you know. The funny thing was, it seemed that Mr. Bell wanted to get my goat, antagonize me, get me on the show to confront Harley Bird, which is probably the last thing in the world I would ever do.
Well, you've already done it.
I've done it.
You've
done
it.
I've made my statement. It's finished, folks, and it's right there in full color. But this is what Art Bell wanted. If he couldn't get in touch with me, he wanted to get in touch with you, Don. And if he couldn't get in touch with you, he wanted to know who he could get to go on the show and talk about Harley Bird. I gave him the name of Eric Beckyard. Now, I understand that Eric Beckyard also tends to deal with fringe elements. Was that being kind?
That's being kind.
Thank you. And after Mr. Bell decides to talk to one of his friends to see what he knew...
I'll tell the whole damn story.
Okay.
It was Brad Steiger.
It was Brad Steiger. Art Bell calls me up again, and he says, I talked to Brad Steiger, and Brad Steiger told me that Harley Bird, even though he's a little strange, he's harmless, and take him with a grain of salt and enjoy him. And he also said, now, Eric Beckyard, he is crazy. He's nuts. He believes Elvis is on the moon. So Bell calls me up, and he confronts me with this again. He says, now you give me Eric Beckyard? This is a man who believes that Elvis is on the moon. And you believe that what he's saying about Harley Bird is the truth? And I said, Art, I know what he is saying about Harley Bird is the truth, because Eric Beckyard took Harley Bird to court. Eric Beckyard got a restraining order against
Harley
Bird.
And had Bird thrown in jail.
Had him thrown in jail. So I don't care if Eric Beckyard has seen Elvis on the moon or if he saw him in Culver City. It doesn't matter to me.
It's very similar.
Yeah, absolutely. He was telling the truth about Harley Bird, and Art Bell wanted someone to be controversial.
But didn't Art Bell ask you what your... What is the word he used, this word which I hate? What word did he say? What is your...
Go ahead.
Agenda.
Oh, God, did he?
Agenda.
Yes, he
your agenda.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Yeah, well, I said to him right off the...
Truth! Bat, did you say truth?
Yes. I said to him, why would I come on your show and confront Harley Bird? And he said, well, you must have an agenda. What's your agenda? I said, I have no agenda. I did this because I was interested in the truth. And he said, well, you know, it sounds, by the tone of your voice, that you hate the man. And I said, I don't hate the man, but if you've gotten poison pen letters from somebody for over 3 years with death threats, I certainly don't like the man. And he said, oh, you've got death threats? I said, yes, I have death threats. He says, did he sign them? I said, yes, he signed them. But of course, he didn't sign them with his name. He used one of his many personas. Well, how do you know? I said, the man is not in the computer generation. He's got a typewriter. He uses the same typewriter on everything he does, with the same misspelling, with the same bad grammar, with the same whiteouts. It doesn't take a genius to figure out it's Harley Andrew Bird. The man's a nutcase. And then he finally calls me the fourth time, and he says, well, you won't come on the show. Eric Beckyard's out of the question, and Don's unavailable. So I've done everything I can.
Well, this is a good time. This is a great time, as a matter of fact. I just happened to tape that show.
Amen, brother.
And coming back from a break, now this is after all the information that was made available to Art, knowing exactly what Harley was all about. He was now introducing Harley as Admiral Byrd's grandson.
And Dr. Bird. He called him Dr. Bird.
And he has graduated to be the grandson, not the nephew.
Now, I can play this because there is no rough language on it, but when Art later asks Harley, well, are you the grandson of Admiral Byrd?
This, one of the two hard questions he asked him.
This, right. This is priceless. So go ahead and run that.
This question earlier. Dr. Bird claims to have received a very special secret document from his grandfather as an inheritance, passed actually at the funeral. This document was a diary account of the Admiral's journey into one of the openings to the subterranean landscape. And then somebody earlier in the day was kind enough to fax me this article from the Los Angeles Times entitled Top Producer Honored.
Okay, now, before we go any further, this article that Art is going to read
Los Angeles Times.
Allegedly from the Los Angeles Times, from the Southern California...
Southern California Film Council Blue Sapphire Award given to Harley Bird for his job as a producer. There is no Southern California Film Council. It doesn't exist. The Time magazine article is a fraudulent paste-up by Harley Andrew Bird.
Okay, now, we have how many copies of paste-ups, Dwight, do we have here?
Do we have about 500 in front of you?
Yeah, this is something that he really does excel in. All right, let's go back to this, because this is a trip. Oh, did you have something, Dwight?
No.
Oh, okay. Go ahead.
Harley Bird, son of Irene Bird of Warner, Oklahoma, has been inducted into the Southern California Motion Picture Council, also awarded the Merit of Service Award, Blue Sapphire Award, along with his wife, Sheila.
Yeah.
The Blue Sapphire Award was presented to Bird for his work on the hit film Rainbow Bridge, plus recent productions, Galaxies on CBS, Secrets of the Pyramids, and his acting work in a CBS movie, Anatomy of a Seduction. Bird is working on a three-part
series
on the late world explorer, Admiral Richard E. Bird, entitled Simply the Admiral. It will air in May, and did, presumably. Bird lives in Sherman Oaks, California, with his wife, has a son, Anthony, who is an attorney in Washington, D.C. And we will get back to the Admiral, and we heard passages already from the secret diary. One in which he flew over what we know as Iceland, he called Eastland at the time, in which he surprisingly located an area bereft of ice and snow.
Now, you know,
and in fact located a subterranean
snow? Iceland is green. Greenland is covered with snow.
One in which it is said that which we know as Sasquatch may reside. Making it a place I'm not likely now to go. Back to Dr. Bird in a moment. Bird. Dr. Bird, are you there?
Yes, sir. Hi.
All right, good. So we have a new audience joining in.
Oh,
that's
good.
Kind of caught them up a little bit. Now,
okay.
Your grandfather flew over this area bereft of snow, and I saw a city.
Right.
And that's where we wanted to start the story again.
Okay.
Did he land?
Yes, he did, and the log will go on here for you. A couple of corrections, Art, if I may be so bold.
You may.
Here we go. I love this.
It's not Harley R. Bird. It's Harley A. Andrew. Harley Andrew Bird.
Oh,
and I didn't say that I was the grandson of Admiral Bird. My father, Everett, said that to his son.
I see. Well,
as per the
what does that mean?
Obituary of Richard Jr.,
okay.
In the New York Times, October 14, 1988.
Well, are you, you are the best custodian.
I assumed that when I was with the Admiral in the business.
You, sir, are the best custodian of your own genealogy, so...
Yeah. Well, I never really doubted it, except there are people who were the pundits who call in to, you know...
Well, have these people so pounded on you that you doubt now?
Sometimes I do, Art. These guys were trying to convince me that I was Stephen Leibowitz, Jr.
Stephen Leibowitz, Jr. Yes. By the way, just to set the record straight, folks, Admiral Richard E. Byrd was a junior. Richard E. Byrd's father was Richard E. Byrd. And his grandfather was William Byrd. And you know how far you got to get all this information on Richard Byrd? Go to your library. Pick up an encyclopedia.
Well, you know, the whole point of even pointing this out, this field has been so illegitimized over the years that it is atrocious. And when someone is claiming to be actively looking for truth, to put a program on like this that literally has the potential of reaching millions of people from coast to coast, it would... this has got to be pointed out, because if people in the UFO research community do not clean their own house, then the skeptics and the debunkers will be much, much happy to do that for us.
One of the points that I made in Quality of the Messenger was that the waters are muddied from within. See, people don't want to believe that. They want to point the finger and say, you're a government agent, or there's disinformation agents out there. When in actuality, it's the sociopaths, it's the frauds, and I hate to say this, but Art Bell has proven to be one of the biggest disinformation agents I have ever seen. Because he knew, by the information we gave him, that there was a question about Harley Byrd, and he didn't handle it as if there was a question. Well,
debunking your favorite stars, this is How Radio Isn't Done on Over the Edge. KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, KPFA.org, all entirely listener-sponsored.
Point is, when asking you, well, who can I get to go on the program? There shouldn't have been a question. He shouldn't have needed anybody to go on the program. If he wanted to put Harley Byrd on, he should have asked, and when he heard that first answer, he should have fired one bullet after the other to sink this guy.